rehearsal club, the rehearsal club. High standards to uphold. To join this set of fresh soubrettes, this fine line we are told. A letter from your pastor, a letter from your priest, a letter from your rabbi, a letter from your grandma at the very least. Good girls only need apply. Good girls only, we tell you why. Virtue in the show is art. Good girls come from older days. Good girls come from everywhere. But you'll meet all of us through the book. Our stories are in the book. And if you go through the museum reflects a lot of our history. So this is the perfect place to launch this whole thing. And I have to thank the co-founder of the museum, Julia Boardman, and Amanda, where are you? Yes, thank you. And Nolan in the back, thank you. I know that none of this is done alone. I mean, everybody, it takes a community. And right now, one of the Cinderellas that's behind the scenes is Francie Mancini. Say hi. She's also in our book, and she's our court reporter today. And behind the camera is Ellen Zolk. Hello, Ellen. Ellen is on our rehearsal club
board of directors, the new, reincorporated, talk about a rebirth, yeah. And who else is doing stuff? Shawnee, are you here?
Yes, she's here.
Shawnee is like one of our Julia Adams, who are rising stars. Shawnee is now living in the new residence, under the umbrella of the rehearsal club, the residency program, right? And she is a rising star. So, and she was part of our competition. Which Julia, that's how we got Julia too, when we did the Rising Star Key Award competition.
Very talented.
Yeah, they're very talented, and we give them showcases wherever we can find it. Okay, and the trailer gave you a lot of our information, background, everything closing down in 1979. But what was amazing was none of the friendships died. We were still friends. I kept seeing all of these people I kind of sort of knew at auditions, and I didn't know where I knew them from, but over the years, especially with Kathy Connery and Maria Mallman over there, brought all of us together in 2006. And, well, that's history. And this book captures a lot of that history. Okay, and I did all that on that page. anyway, my name is Denise Pence, and I am your host for this evening. And we would like to start off the proceedings with Melinda Tanner over there in the corner. We're going to read excerpts from each of our stories. Not long, but we timed it out. It's a good 45 minutes. So I hope you went to the you know where. And I hope you enjoy all of our stories. We loved writing them, and there's a lot of history in all of them. Melinda, take it away.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Thank you for being standing up at all. I mean, I'm really proud of myself today. I lived at the club from 1969 to 1972, and I'm just going to read an excerpt from my story. I was 21, and I wanted to do musicals. My voice teacher in LA insisted I give New York some serious thought, but I didn't know anyone there except two friends from college, Vern, an actor slash pharmacist who lived in Greenwich Village, and Cher, who lived somewhere on 53rd Street. So I wrote to both of them, and they both wrote me back with basically two words of advice. Bring money. Well, I had confidence that this was the right thing to do, and I was so naive, I had no fear. My plans were very simple. I had only about $1,000 I could put together, and I'd find a place to live when I got there. Well, staying with my friend Vern was out of the question, but Sherry wrote that she lived in a theatrical boarding house called the Rehearsal Club, and that she would talk to the headmistress there and see what she could do. So I gave notice at my apartment in LA, gave my car to my brother with instructions to sell it if I decided to stay in NYC. And finally, I picked a date, bought a one-way ticket, and spread the word. This would be my first solo flight anyplace. I landed at JFK on July 6, 1969. The passengers disembarked down the stairs onto the tarmac in those days. And when I stepped off the plane, a gust of hot, humid air hit me like a fist. I could hardly breathe. This was my first taste of East Coast summers. Vern sent instructions to take the bus to the East Side Airlines terminal on First Avenue, and he would meet me there. And he was waiting as I dragged my luggage off the bus. We had no wheels on luggage in those days, remember? So the next day I knew Vern and I were in my very first taxi in the middle of Manhattan. I'll never forget those first sights and smells of that humid afternoon in that cab, finally knowing I wasn't in Kansas anymore. The smell of that heavy air filled with food, incense, perspiration, exhaust, and wet concrete was surrounding me. It was exhilarating. In my hand was a folded and dog-eared 3x5 index card with two names and addresses on it. The Barbizon Hotel for Women on Lexington and 63rd, and the Rehearsal Club at 47 West 53rd Street. We stopped at the Barbizon first. Vern waited in the cab while I went in. The lobby was elegant and huge and sophisticated. I went to the desk and asked if they had a room and what the details were. The manager said they had a vacancy, and the rent was $50 per week, one meal per day, and girls had to dress for dinner. I thanked her and went back out to the cab. Vern suggested we go directly to the rehearsal club to compare. Now, by now, it was late afternoon, and I still didn't know where I would sleep that night. When we arrived at the RC, we dragged my bags up the flight of stairs to the giant black doors. I rang the bell. A small woman answered the door, wearing a salmon-colored uniform with white piping, white shoes, and a nurse-like cap. Her name was Addie, and she smiled. It was the first smile I had seen since I arrived. She ushered us into the living room. I introduced myself and I asked if my friend Sherry was in. She said she would check. She walked past the giant staircase at the entrance and rang the bell that sounded on the second floor. Someone yelled down, "Yes!" Addie yelled back, "Your friend Melinda's here!" Well, she screamed and she came barreling down the long staircase and into the living room. And we hugged and laughed, and she ushered me into the office of the headmistress, Debbie Dare. Now, Mrs. Dare was in her combination office and apartment, which had a huge grand piano in the center with a shawl draped over it, with old Persian carpets and the tallest ceilings I had ever seen. Speaking of tall, so was she. She was about 5'9 to my 5'4, wearing all black with a long strand of pearls. Her hair was parted in the center with circular braids on either side of her head. And when she spoke, she sounded like a Wagnerian opera singer. I had never been to an opera yet either. Now she asked me some questions and said the rent would be $33 a week, with two meals a day, except on weekends. Well, that beat the Barbizon by $17. And finally, she came around at her desk and walked toward me, took my head in her large hands, looked closely into my eyes and asked, "Are you a good girl?" I just stared at her and I didn't move. I glanced over at Sherry sitting there and she went, "Yes, Mrs. Dare," I said. She smiled. "Well then, we don't have any vacancies at the moment, but since it's getting dark and you have no other lodgings, I will put a cot outside Sherry's room and you can stay there tonight. But you'll have to make other arrangements tomorrow." After putting my bags in room 24 on the second floor, Sherry, Vern, and I went out to dinner at Joanne's on 46th Street, my first popular theater bar where I had my first pecan pie. The next day, and every day after that, for 2 weeks, I was told I could stay just one more night. And each day, I'd repeat that I had no other place to go. And finally, Sherry decided to go back to LA, and I got her bed. One by one, I befriended many of the 39 other women living at the club. Michel and Denise are among them. And looking back, the instant support and similar goals and experiences we shared made New York a safer place. We had each other's backs.
Glad you're all here on this lovely day. Reflections. I remember my father saying, "You can't kick high enough." My aunt said, "There's a broken heart for every play on Broadway." My dance teacher, when I interviewed her about family life, said, "Having a family is difficult." Was I being discouraged by these comments, or was my belief being tested? Armed with my dream, I took my first plane, a prop, from my supportive hometown of St. Petersburg, Florida, in the summer of 1962. Armed with my dream, well, let's skip to that one. I had been chosen earlier to become a Rockette at the famed Radio City Music Hall. As I think back, how was my mother so brave as to let me go? My leaving home meant she would be all alone, as my father, my grandmother had all passed away within months of my leaving. Well, now my mother was worried about my safety. Where was I going to go? Where was I going to live? She warned me not to go above 59th Street and never to go into Central Park alone at night. Well, fortunately, Emily Sherman, a Rockette dance captain, referred me to the rehearsal club, 3 blocks away from the stage door. I requested an interview, and I must have met the criteria, as surprisingly, Miss Stevenson at the time had a room and said I could move in immediately. Well, my mother's prayers were answered, and I had landed in a pot of jam. I was accepted into the rehearsal club. I left college before my 3rd year and thought I had missed out on college dorm life, but suddenly, here I was with like-minded, independent women in pursuit of a career in theater. Well, that was thrilling, and it was better than a college dorm life, as we were like a sitcom. We shared laughter, knowledge of the industry, and stories, good times and difficult times. And the price? $22 a week, 2 meals a day, rehearsal in TV room, clean linen, and a parlor room that we could entertain our friends. Now, the club became my home for the 3-year time limit. And during that time, I went from becoming a Rockette to landing a contract with the famed Latin Quarter on Broadway. And by 1964, I became an equity member as I had signed a principal contract for the DuPont show at the World's Fair in Flushing Meadows, Queens, New York. Well, so Mom, I had gone past 59th Street, and yes, Dad, I could kick high enough as I became a Rockette. I wish you had known. So, I finally went past 59th Street. Oh, I told you that one already. Anyway, after leaving the club, several Broadway shows followed. There was Golden Rainbow, Coco, 42nd Street, and a revival of My Fair Lady. And while you're here at the Broadway Museum, maybe you will find information on those shows. But during the time I lived at the rehearsal club, great lessons were learned and wonderful friendships were made. And I encourage you all to buy our book because there's a lot more stories in there and all very different.
Next up is Michel Mason. And Michel wrote an anthem to optimism. And to this day, she's actually brought all of our women together on a weekly basis doing a meditation workshop that started in COVID. And it kept us all together during Zoom, right? So she's still our optimistic woman. So take it away, Michel.
Thank you, Denise.
You're welcome.
So good to see everybody. And many people who come to meditation, too. It's nice to see you here today, too.
We all like to come.
Well, I came to New York all the way from, okay, New York. Well, via Long Island at the time. It was the early 70s. Wow. A native New Yorker, I was aspiring to a career in musical comedy. My talented vocal coach, Walter, and his wife, Eileen, a professional actress, knew of a residence for actresses in Manhattan. They called on my behalf for an interview with Mrs. Clayton, the house mother. I passed my interview with Mrs. Clayton, and on a hot July day, my parents drove me, a bit apprehensively, to the front door and to my new life at the club. As I ascended the wooden stairs to the 3rd floor front room, it was just the beginning of meeting some of the incredible girls, the women of the rehearsal club. I had several roommates while living in different rooms of the club, and I made dear lifelong friends, like the bloody Melinda over there. She was it. It was the people who were the heart and soul of the club. And the club seemed to have a heart too, a character all its own. I awoke each morning to go downstairs for early breakfast and to vocalize and run songs at the piano in the practice room. Then I was off to my civilian gig, a waitress job at the iconic restaurant Schraff's on Madison Avenue. and then to vocal coaching, acting classes, auditions, then late dinner at the club. Phew. I admit, I prayed for a show. Prayed at St. Malachy's, the Actors' Chapel on 49th Street, and knelt in the pews of St. Patrick's, not too far from the club. But when was I going to get my break into the theater? I was still at Shrapp's. Like Adelaide in Guys and Dolls, I seem to be developing some psychosomatic symptoms.
Affecting the upper respiratory tract.
I had a chronic cold that just wasn't going away. The steam heat in my room wasn't helping any either. Propped up on my dresser was a favorite quote at the time. Life is a mystery to be lived, not a problem to be solved. Deep. Was there a divine message I wasn't getting? Then hallelujah, I got a show, and my cold miraculously disappeared. My big song was going to be Cheer Up, an anthem to optimism. Perfect. There's a line in the Kaufman Ferber play, The Royal Family, where the leading lady asks the all too familiar question, am I center? Of course we wanted to be center, but now realize we were also really part of a rehearsal club ensemble. An ensemble that spans generations. Today we have the privilege to meet and know many RC women who have lived there across time. I share the friendship and love of dear Phyllis Jean Creor Westerman, World War II canteen girl and songwriter. Yeah, we all love Phyllis very much. And Phyllis also introduced TV for the first time as Miss Television at the 1939 World's Fair here in New York, right out in Flushing Meadows. Phyllis passed at 100 years young. Phyllis always had a special place in her heart for the club. And I also like to mention that Kathleen Connery, our RC alum and founder, she couldn't be here with us this morning, but she wrote a beautiful piece in our book on Phyllis called A Centenary Cinderella, noting that in addition to all her many accomplishments and her friendships with us, and I quote, Phyllis has been a central part of the inspiration for this book, unquote. So thank you, you big, beautiful brownstone, for giving me more than just a place to live, eat, rehearse, and dream. For lifelong friends, who are there for one another through thick and thin. For happiness, a richer life, and many fond memories of a truly unique experience. May our light shine.
Next up is Donna Couteau, who she may be our one and only, or yeah, she is the Native American Indian. Take it away, Donna.
Thank you, Denise. Hi, my native name is Mayoname, and I'm a proud citizen of the Sac and Fox Nation of Oklahoma, an RC resident in 1971. I'd like to dedicate my story in memory of my mother, who always wanted me to write. These are excerpts from my story entitled, From Peter Pan to Princess Teyada. They say that if you truly lived in the 70s, you don't remember them. What I do remember are my husband's parting words. You'll be back! You're nothing but a ballet animal. You're past your prime. And anyway, you got no talent.
Ugh, my heart is in my throat. I had butterflies in my stomach. But I just knew I had to try it one more time. When I finally arrived in New York City on that night train, the rehearsal club didn't really have room for me. So I camped out on a cot in the hallway for a couple of weeks. The house mother, who spoke a little French, was very kind to me and asked about my family name, Couteau, which is the French word for knife. I told her about my dad from Oklahoma, my mom from Louisiana, who were both of Native American heritage, and that I looked more like my mom. The house mother said that I might well be the only American Indian
that had ever lived at the rehearsal club. I was glad that she had taken an interest in me and recommended me for a couple of modeling and publicity shots for the rehearsal club. They were printed in the New York Daily News. All the women that I met at the club were very helpful and gave me information about the trades, backstage and variety, and where to go for headshots for auditions. I didn't have a lot of confidence at first. I remember at one Broadway audition when they called my name for the second time, I panicked. Someone mentioned I might have to sing or speak lines in a play. Speak? Dancers don't speak. I was too shy. That's why I danced. I fled the theater. Sitting on the ground in Central Park as a Disney audition time drew near, I found myself thinking about how on the way to work one day, I accidentally bumped into a fantasy heartthrob of mine, an actor from the Gidget movies. He had asked me to join him for a drink at one of the theatrical hangouts, the Haymarket. What a boost for my ego. He reminded me of how fabulous it was to be back in New York with all its unknown possibilities. I decided then and there, I was going to that Disney audition. The audition covered everything from point work to tap, but no singing. I got the job and I went for the costume fitting for Peter Pan the same day. That evening, television reporter Pia Lindstrom visited the club doing a human interest story about all the residents. It was hilarious trying to get me to recreate the moment I got the telephone confirmation about my job. But now I knew for sure I was on the right path. If your dream keeps coming back, it is your destiny. I eventually married my soulmate, Joe Cross, from the Caddo Nation of Oklahoma. He and I found ourselves on the Good Red Road after meeting Hopi spiritual leader Thomas Binyaka outside of the United Nations. We formed our award-winning company called Leaf Arab Storytellers and became a part of American history when we were chosen as 2 of 14 storytellers in the Western Hemisphere to open the Smithsonian National Museum of the American Indian on the Mall in Washington, D.C. in 2004. It was also very exciting for us to tour internationally in Beijing, China, Paris, Switzerland, and Germany. Seeing the Great Wall and all the sights along the way was an experience I'll never forget. This has been my journey, part of my journey, thanks to the generosity of many, the support of my sisters from the rehearsal club long ago and today. So like Judy Garland sang in Somewhere Over the Rainbow, the dreams that you dare to dream really do come true. Today, my husband and I are still active with Native American committees at Screen Actors Guild, AFTRA, as well as the committees for American Indian Community to continue promoting inclusion and diversity in the arts. I also contribute as a writer and performance in Women and Violence, Material Witness, which was about missing and murdered Indigenous women, and Misdemeanor Dream, which is touring the US and Canada for Spider Woman Theater, the longest running Native feminist performance group in existence. So here's looking at you, Mom.
Next up is Maria Mallman, who I said earlier was co-founder with all of
with Kathy Conry.
With Kathy Conry, keeping all of us together.
Back in 2006. This will be brief. It's about our second review, the anniversary review. In 1963, my 3-year residency limit at the club was coming to an end. So it seemed appropriately fitting to say my thank yous. During our 50th anniversary review, a tall stool was carried out by my friend and housemate, Maxine Fox, who became the future producer of Grease on Broadway. I then walked out onto a darkened stage, and once seated, a spotlight came on. Acknowledging our honorary board, our then president, Mrs. Philip D. Wilson, who is our current president, Gail Patron's grandmother, Minnie, I went on to acknowledge the board of managers and guests. Incidentally, I found Gail searching through states and in Puerto Rico. I then spoke directly to Carol Burnett. I said, since your arrival in New York City, you have repeatedly supported the Rehearsal Club. And during the club's 50-year history, exceptionally talented you cared to produce its two reviews. Through the publication of your first book, and thereafter in public broadcasting interviews, you brought the knowledge of the club and your connection into the minds of nationwide viewers. You always spoke so lovingly of our shelter and our board. Then after leaving residency, you planned an audition competition to meet the terms of your benefactor. You generously awarded the winner the cost of room and board for a whole year. Carol, I am that recipient.
Oh.
And from deeply within my heart, I thank you. You taught us all to pay it forward. As historian and co-founder with Kathy Connery, I became friends with Carol's roommates, Maven Hughes Sherman and Christina Tinker Gillespie. And I hosted several luncheons. When Carol received my invitation to join her first review participants, she personally called my home, and she said my name with that Tarzan yell. And she spoke with me. She said, I'll put the kettle on and join you in spirit. So I baked a cake, two in fact, and sent them to her. You will find my personal recipe in the book, along with Carol's response. Denise has asked me to speak of my bio. With the help of several agents, I have worked nightclub commercials, recordings, radio, TV, and films and stage. I have appeared at the Martinique Theater and with the New York Shakespeare Festival under the direction of Gladys Vaughn and Joseph Papp. My professional membership is still with SAG-AFTRA and has been with Actors Equity and ANVA. I am currently a life member of Entertainment Community Fund, which was formerly known as the Actors Fund. Since 2006, I've been known as the Rehearsal Club historian for having searched and located over 150 former residents toward establishing with Kathy Conrad, this alumni. I spent several years on the steering committee and was its first secretary. In conclusion, my most joyful production is my daughter and best friend, Christine Feingold, an alumni member. Thank you all.
Is Julia Adams, who's making history with all of us. Take it away, Julia.
Right. Hello. I'm here to share Betty Bigger's Galvano story. She was a resident of the Rehearsal Club from 1957 to 1958, and I'm going to be reading two short stories. The first is called Ed Sullivan to the Rescue. For my scene on the Ed Sullivan Show that night, I would be sitting in a bathtub without water, a towel wrapped around my head while I dreamed of Tony Bennett, who was really on the show and singing because of you. Then, after I got out of the tub and put on an evening gown, I would be introduced as one of the top 10 models in the country. I should have been full of excitement, but I wasn't. Ed had known me from other shows. He asked what was bothering me. In a trembling voice, I explained to him that the week before, someone with a blackjack had followed me home from the lab where I worked at New York University and tried to strangle me with some leather strings. A law student had saved me from tragedy. Now it was impossible to stay in the same apartment. I couldn't sleep or eat. I had to find another place to live. Ed Sullivan was aghast. How frightening! You have to move, he said in a concerned voice. Immediately, he had his secretary make a phone call. A few minutes later, Ed told me to go up the street to the rehearsal club at 47 West 53rd Street, a small distance from where we were working at CBS's Studio 50 on 6th Avenue and 53rd Street. I still had time on my break to meet a Mrs. Keck who would be waiting for me. Now the second story is called Prince Charming. Sorry. The Hamburger Train was a popular place in the show business district and was located on the corner of 6th Avenue and 53rd Street, just a half a block from the rehearsal room. Only about 15 people at a time could be served. Everyone sat on stools at the counter. When your order was ready, the cook put it on a flatbed car of a Lionel train, which then rolled around the counter on a track and stopped in front of you. After you took your order off of the flatbed car, the train continued around the counter and back to the cook. Alex was the cook, the manager, and the owner, and everyone knew he loved what he was doing. One morning, June 25th, 1958, I slid onto a stool and ordered my favorite breakfast, a glazed donut and a cup of coffee. Suddenly, I became acutely aware of an energy flowing from someone sitting on the stool next to me. When Alex introduced us to each other, I turned to look at the man. My heart skipped a beat and I nearly swooned. His dazzling eyes seemed to penetrate deeply into my soul. I wanted to stroke his massive black hair and gently touch his mustache to see if he was real. His contagious smile with those beautiful white teeth set me on fire. What was happening? I had heard of love at first sight. Was this it? His name was Phil Galvano. When I got ready to leave, Phil unexpectedly paid for my breakfast and for the coffee and donuts that I was taking back to my roommates at the rehearsal club. I knew the girls would be happy to have a free breakfast. Before we parted, Phil asked me if he could call me sometime. Would he call? 2 minutes later, I walked into the rehearsal club. The one phone was ringing. Betty, it's for you, someone shouted. I went to the phone and couldn't believe it. It was Phil asking, may I take you to dinner tonight? And so began our romance, which included his singing the most beautiful Italian love songs to me on his ukulele. I later learned that he lived across the street. His apartment was on the fourth floor. My room was on the third floor. We could actually spy on each other. Was this a good thing? I knew we would both be keeping the drapes closed. My roommates began waking me up when they saw Phil leaving his apartment building in the mornings. I would throw a scarf over my head and pull on a trench coat, saunter into the Hamburger Train, and act surprised to see Phil. I'd have coffee with him, and then he would offer to pay for the coffee and donuts I always took back to the girls. It was a little bit of a racket. Phil was amused, but understood the girls were struggling to work and spent their extra money on classes. Besides, seeing Phil often was wonderful for both of us, because I knew we were in love. Our whirlwind romance lasted little more than 4 months. We married on November 8, 1958. Now today, Betty and her husband, known as Mr. Broadway, built and ran the Santa Rosa Country Club in Bradenton, Florida. Their marriage lasted 38 beautiful years when Phil passed away in 1996, just as his first grandchild was being born. Betty is blank years young, living in Florida.
Thank you, Julia. I missed setting Betty up because Betty actually came to New York to do the centennial with all of us, performed at the York with us as a Ziegfeld showgirl. She was amazing. And she was part of the book early on. I like to think that we inspired her to write her whole book. She's a very religious woman. So she ended up self-publishing her own book called Zapped by the Spirit. And when she got that out in the public, we were getting closer and closer to trying to get our book published. It's like most people thought, this is never going to happen. And then I asked Betty if we could excerpt the little stories that pertain specifically to the rehearsal club, and she gave us that permission. Thank you, Julia. You did a great job. Is 6 degrees of separation. Glynnis O'Connor reading for her mother, Lenka Peterson, who you met in the trailer earlier. Okay, she talked about the love between the girls, right? And Lenka, when I was trying to get Lenka's story into our book, she was much older and she was losing her thought, trailing memories, all of this. And Glynnis came to my rescue. And we both worked to get the stories from your mother to add them to the book. And Glynnis, as I get to know her, is the 6 degrees of separation is that she starred opposite Robbie Benson, who was a kid. He must have been 12 years old when I first met him, and he was in The Rothschilds, which was my first show on Broadway. So then I'm meeting Glynnis, and I'm going, oh my God. We're connected. Okay, so Glynnis is going to read her mother's story. Thank you.
Thanks. My mother,
Lenka, lived at the rehearsal club in 1948. Her story, entitled Kiss and Tell, it was the title of the USO show she did during World War II. This is a short excerpt. One of my all-time vivid memories was standing in Times Square the night the war ended. My breath runs away from me even now. I had never really seen much of New York City, and I loved just going out and wandering the streets. And one evening, I walked out of the rehearsal club and down toward Times Square, and I was standing next to a lamppost, and there was a policeman there, so I thought I'd be safe. And all of a sudden, the lights went on everywhere in Times Square. They'd been off all during the war, and there I was, standing there watching as all the lights turned on in all the buildings all over Times Square. Made my whole body aches every time I think about it. How thrilling and unimaginably amazing that was. I mean, isn't that funny? There are whole years that go by, and I can't remember much about what went on in them, but that moment, oh my God, I can remember what the post felt like when I leaned against it and everything. And as fate would have it, I met my soon-to-become forever new agent, Sarah Enright, in the basement restaurant of the rehearsal club. And after that, it felt like I went from show to show to show. And I don't remember ever having to have a real job. So the rehearsal club launched my mother, Lenka, into a 70-year career as a professional actor. A charter member of the Actors Studio, she starred in a dozen Broadway productions, receiving a Tony nomination for Quilters, multiple off-Broadway and regional theater productions and feature films, and over 1,000 telefilms and series. Her years of creating and directing theater groups for young people are captured in her book, Kids Take the Stage. Lenka passed on September 24th, 2021, at age 95. I and my four brothers miss both our parents every day, and we are so delighted that her Cinderella story is preserved in this book. Thank you.
Action camera. All right. Okay, so I came to New York when Panic in Needle Park was popular. It was not a nice place. And it was the summer of 1970, and the title of my story is Greenhorn Texan. I was so green. Okay. This is it. This
is the rehearsal club? It's so old and small and dirty. Oh, feeling slightly lost and not at all sure this summer adventure to study dance at the Martha Graham School in New York was such a good idea, I stepped hesitantly from the cab. The driver, of course, seemed to have as little patience with me as he had for every other driver on the road into Manhattan, and quite rudely, I thought, acted like I was trying to get away without paying. I mean, geez, I'm from New York. I'm from Texas. They don't do things like that in Texas. How much is it from LaGuardia to 53rd Street and 6th Avenue? $20. Oh my God, that's half a week's rent in this place, and I'm getting two meals a day for that. Ugh. Are you kidding me? Okay, well, not much left for my tip, but I got a really tight budget while I'm here. Okay, thank you for such a pleasant ride. The driver just gunned the gas and dismissed me and my precious tip in a squeal of tires. Great way to begin my life in New York City. Now I'm going to skip a little bit on this story because I wrote a lot. Oh God. They moved me into this gigantic room with four other women, which, according to Carol Burnett on her last talk show, that must have been the same room. So there were four women in there, and I got a cot. That first night, when it seemed like everyone in the club camped out in my room to meet the new girl, all of a sudden, the filth and rudeness of the city disappeared, and I suddenly felt totally at home. Everyone gathered around my cot, sharing their dreams and drama of auditions, all of which seemed terribly exciting to someone who'd never stepped outside a dance class. I immediately wanted to find a way to stay in this amazing, energized environment. The rehearsal club, a broken down brownstone in the middle of the universe, would prove to be a haven of inspiration, support, and friendships that would, unknown to me at the time, last a lifetime. I'm gonna skip down again to when I picked up a copy of Backstage and I got four of my Martha Graham friends to go to this open call for the Rothschilds. And one by one, my friends got cut. And I just kept moving onto a new set of dance challenges. When they finally pulled the last group on stage, they said, "We're done for today, but they would like to come back tomorrow again and be prepared to sing." Sing! I have never sung in my life, not even in church. Oh my God. I walked back to the rehearsal club in an absolute daze. And what was I going to do? Donna, I think we related. Well, I should have known that those girls at the rehearsal club would know immediately what to do. Someone, and yeah, we know it's Melinda over there in the corner. She was the go-to girl for everything. And she also did the cover of our book, just so you know. She took me down, pulled out a bunch of music scores, hauled me downstairs to the cafeteria where a rehearsal piano was available for the residents, and started asking me what song she thought I might already kind of know. Well, you'll have to read the book to see what happens to the audition. Okay, but I did get the show that literally changed my life. I met and eventually married my dance partner, who at the time was considered the bad boy of Broadway. And he's sitting in the middle of this audience because he never leaves me alone. Everyone warned me away from this man. And this year we're celebrating our golden anniversary. I wish this world had more men like him in it. He's incredible.
encouraged, supported, protected, and stuck by me as I grew and changed so very much, rest from the greenhorn Texan that came into town in 1970. Always my Sir Galahad. I love you. Okay, today we're empty nesters after raising two amazing daughters who we believe met and married their perfect soulmates. Jolyn recently gave us a beautiful, amazing granddaughter named River, and our youngest, Brett, discovered during COVID her own unique gift for art. You can find her on Amazon Beauty Art on Instagram. Meanwhile, I remain completely grateful to the many new, friendships from the rehearsal club, which sprang from Kathy's question to me in 2006, did you ever live at the rehearsal club? The rest is history, and I hope you enjoy reading the fuller stories and rich history that can happen when the collective creativity of like-minded good girls comes together to support each other's dreams. This book was a big one. We hope you enjoyed our show. And does anyone have any questions for any of us before we start signing books? Yes, dear.
I have something very strange to say, I guess. This morning, as usual, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, MSNBC I watch. And it was a rehashing of CNN's showing of Trump. Right after that, MSNBC gave a full breakdown of George Santos. And then I come here, and I kind of get like a 180 pendulum swing to such wonderful, fulfilling, lovely ladies that I'm overwhelmed at the understanding of what we really should be and probably are all about. And I thank my wife for pushing all of the things that she did with the help of the rehearsal club to get this book done, because it is fairly miraculous that it got done. And the ladies up front, who I know very well, more delicious than you've ever been before in my eyes. And I just hope that we continue on in this vein and this type of event lives and the other garbage falls by the wayside. Thank you so much.
Eons
ago, and his wife Maria. What do you have a question, Mark?
Another question. I just want to salute Alice Middleton.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Because just after I'd been hired by Joe Papp in Central Park, that was my first professional job, because Joe Papp saw me in as Romeo in Romeo and Juliet in my senior play at the American Academy. And he hired me the next day. I actually had to get a day off from the tour of Romeo and Juliet. I was standby for his Romeo. And go back to get graduated. And then went back to Shakespeare Festival. And I stayed there for quite a while. And then in the fall of that year, first of all, I got married that same year.
Oh, yeah.
So we were about to celebrate our 62nd.
Oh.
And in the December of 61, my first child had been born, and I did a play called The Cradle of Willow at the Church of the Ascension, which is an Episcopal church up high on the hill, 155th Street in Broadway. And Alice Middleton came to see me in it, and she left me a note with her card. I said, please call me. I think I can help your career. So I called her the next day. She was casting, and she sent me to a lady who was a head casting for one of the big ad agencies. And within 3 weeks, I landed my first commercial, which was for green Vaseline hair tonic. But nevertheless, it started my career because she also sent me to other commercial things I did, you know, all the TV things.
That's awesome.
But Alice Middleton was a prime mover in my career.
Yeah, Alice and Phyllis Creor, the canteen girl, and her mother, Linka Peterson, they were like a part of all of us early on when we were first coming together with these little gatherings. We were calling them meetings, but they were really just opportunities to come together and be friends. Anyone else have any questions?
Excuse me, Mark. We've come full circle from when you were in Macbeth, rehearsing on 105th Street, which was the Shakespeare Festival with Bill Devane and Charlie Durney. Do you remember?
Oh, we're all connected.
He was one of your witches. And I still got the program. And the phone numbers. You're still living in the same.
By the way, that tour went on. We toured Connecticut,
yes,
and all around New York State.
Yes.
Nothing like playing the Scottish play to a group in, you know, upper Rochester or whatever. It was strange.
Nice to see you.
We did well. Yeah.
This is an example of forever being connected.
Yeah.
6 degrees of separation in the theater. Hey, Abram. Any other questions, especially from the people who are not family over here? Oh, I met Patricia and Steve. I'm sorry. Yes.
All family. All family.
I think it was a Julie who left the Latin Quarter in '63.
Sorry.
Hi. I was the lead jazz dancer.
What now?
At the Latin Quarter.
At the Latin Quarter.
Oh my gosh.
I was called Tim then.
Now that was the Venus Touch.
That's right.
Oh my God.
I thought you were so handsome out there.
Can I tell a story?
Maybe it's.
Yes, tell another story.
Well, you know, these men, look at this, were gorgeous. They were Roman gladiators. Yeah. I thought they were hunks, you know? And I really did an everyday. I never knew about stage door Johnnies. I swear, I lived the life of a nun in New York. I going to bed, you know, as early as you could, 2 o'clock in the morning after your show, getting up to go to class the whole next day. But I somehow, somebody invited another girl and myself out, dinner or something. And so I came to the dressing room with all the girls, and I said, do you think I can get a blind date with, you know, downstairs with one of the guys? Well, they weren't all just guys then, you know. I didn't know the difference. I was green, too. And they said to me, Jean. I said, what do you mean? Oh, well, I said, no, wouldn't somebody like to go out with my friend? So that's when I learned about how many wonderful people there are in the business and gorgeous. I thought about this since we've done the book. I think we were the women's movement before it became made so famous by Gloria Steinem. Because we were independent.
Yes.
And we didn't have to wear bow ties to prove it and look like a man.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because there I was in feathers, you know. And how dare she tell me, you know, that I need to have another life. Anyway, it was great.
I always thought that about all of our girls. Anybody who could come to New York not knowing anyone, and that's why the rehearsal club was so, so valuable. And it's kind of being revived, but I'll tell you the truth, I think they need a Rocky, another Rockefeller, another big money bags to try and donate another building.
Yeah.
A small building, not a huge building, because the bigger you get, the less intimate it is, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
And we are family because we are small. And we were in a house that, when we were there, it was 40 girls, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, that song says it. Charlie was amazing doing this song, The Good Girls Only. And, you know, that's another, find a producer. How Prince is gone. Are there any other, what?
She's directing.
Ellen is a director type. Do we have any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
I don't know. My name is Hito. I'm from Japan.
Okay.
I'm friend of Jean.
Okay.
I don't know who to ask this question because all these ladies are just wonderful and beautiful, and I know there are more stories. But I, as a singer, dancer, actress, would love to hear what is the most important message or advice for someone like me, younger, who are kind of still living my dream. Yeah,
I'm sure we all have an answer to that. My big,
go to the
But I'm a big mouth too, and what I've learned in my old age is faith in self and getting yourself a community that can support you. Most everything that I have ever done for this rehearsal club has taught me my own power. And it's taught me, because these girls have been there to say, yeah, go do it. Even today, I wanted Kathy to be doing what I'm doing today.
Go, Melinda.
She's fired tonight.
Well,
I know.
We're
sharing. Don't give up your dream.
Okay.
To yourself be true.
Okay.
Oh.
Thank you.
I stole the mic from Melinda.
You stole it from
Melinda. Well, okay. And I'll be right back. So I just want to say, I know Hito, and she's a fabulously talented woman. And didn't you sing like at, what was that, Radio City? Carnegie Hall.
Radio City.
Oh my God.
Radio City, Carnegie Hall. Keep doing what you're doing. You guys got to get connected too. So Julia's fabulous.
And Shawnee.
Yes.
All the rehearsal.
Yes, network like we all did. And you might wind up, Donna was at the club when I was at the club. It's amazing how we all, you know, we all just stuck together. So many people here. Betsy, I've known before the club. I mean, Walter Farrell. I mean, it's great. It's a beautiful, beautiful family. Family. Be yourself. Have fun.
Trust yourself.
Join the rehearsal club.
No, I'm the membership chair.
No, I met you once. We'll all get together separately because this is, you know, I am the annoying because when we were all at the club and before and shortly after until it closed in 79, we didn't have this digital communication system set up for instant information. We had to pass it verbally onto each other, or we would have somebody would publish something and we follow leads literally at a moment's notice and do our time standing in line and doing all that stuff. But I think it's even better today because, you know, there still is less jobs and more people for each job. That's just the reality of this particular choice we made day and time. And so it's really, you know, networking is really incredible, really incredible. Within your skill set, too. But we'll talk more about that.
Yes,
more.
Yes. Yeah. Right across the street.
Yes. Yeah. A lot of us live in the same neighborhood, so we can meet up.
You'll never get rid of us. Okay, well, that's the deal. I would like, if there's any other questions, Terry, are you heading out? Are you okay? Okay. If there aren't any other questions, I'd like the Cinderellas who are in the audience to stand up and let me introduce you. This is Debbie Andrews. Debbie, if you would stand over here, we're going to be signing books, and you're welcome to get signatures from all of our Cinderellas. Debbie is one of our Cinderellas, although she's not in the book.
Did we get her picture in the book?
Got my picture.
We got the picture in the book. We got the gallery, which got a lot of the alums in the book. Margaret Strome, come on down. So I was in the Rock Musical Hair in 71, and I was a little off the reservation for the rehearsal club. But I think what I want to speak to is they were all theater majors, and the year before I was at the rehearsal club, I was a junior in high school in Detroit, you know, skipping class and going to the IHOP. That's what I was doing. But Hair hired a lot of singers, you know, pop singers, you know, that's what I was. And, but what I want
want to speak to about the rehearsal club is just how cool the girls were. They were all theater majors, and they didn't know what I was doing there. But the thing was, well, I was on Broadway, so it was kind of a reverse thing. I wasn't looking for work. And when I met Jan Clayton, who was running the place at the time, I had an interview with her because Breadcrumb, a girl in the Chicago cast of her, said, because I was living at the President Hotel around from the Biltmore Theater, and it was like, not great. So she said, go to the rehearsal club, which I'd never heard of. So again, a breadcrumb, and I went there and I talked to Jan Clayton, and she was like, we don't really have room. They didn't even offer me that cot in the hall. So, but as I was leaving, I said, you know, I have a job. I was so young, I didn't even think to tell her I had a job on Broadway. I'm like, oh, you know, I have a job. She was like, well, wait a minute, you know. So, and so then I got her. But the girls were amazing. I was there with Melanie Mayron and Elizabeth Kemp and Linda Cool and Roberta Roden and all these people.
These great people.
And Melinda. And the thing is, you know, after a show, as I'm sure you guys all know, there's nothing to do. Like, you're kind of all wound up. I go back to the rehearsal club and we just hang out in the rooms. These guitars would come out, an occasional joint. And the girls, what I'm saying is they weren't just those, you know, cookie cutter theater majors. They were just really cool people, you know, and I enjoyed them a lot.
Awesome. Supplement to the book for sure. Wait, where did Francine go? She was just there. Oh, there you are. Only if you want to stand up and do a whole thing. Or you're doing the
I don't have to do a thing.
Okay. Okay. Do you want to say a few words like Debbie did, or anything?
I'll say very few words, but I went to the rehearsal club. Somebody had told me about it, and I was, you know, full of stars in my eyes and my little suitcase, and I met Mrs. Clayton, who had the scotch tape on her forehead, and she put me on a cot in a room. Well, actually, she put me in the fourth floor, where I guess everybody starts, and then I moved down to the second floor. But I thought she was gonna kick me out because I had to audition, and then I got a little piece of paper that, you know, please come and talk to me. And I was like, oh no, I didn't pass the audition. And then I found out I was just moving to another room. So it really helped me transition into New York, which I, to this day, I've been here 50 years, and I love New York City, so.
I came from an art college, and I think that was audition enough. They figured it would, you know, if I could get into an art college, I must have the goods. So,
I had
but others had to audition. And they auditioned, it started, I think it started after I got in that they had to audition.
I think so.
Maybe so.
Not everybody auditioned.
But I think they, the residents, Shawnee, you had to do a thing, right?
Oh, we do.
Yeah. And back in the day, but I was told that because I came from an art college. I don't know. So
Cam, did you audition?
Cam have two references.
No, I had a reference. Okay. I had a reference from someone I was doing the dinner theater with in Woodbridge, Virginia, who said, if you go to New York, you must live at the rehearsal club. I called up in the middle of July, and I came right on it.
Good. There's a story. And next, so Cameron, come up. And Judith, come up. And who else? Nancy, come up.
Nancy
White. How many people bought books in here that's going to want signings? Okay. Because these are all the girls.
Sunny's back there, too.
Sunny, come on up. Sunny. We're going to separate the men from the boys here.
You and I are Couteau.
We're going to tell our stories.
These people are after me.
Then separate it.
Most of the people are after me. I'm liberated. Even Denise. But you and I.
Okay.
Oh, hi. Good to see you.
And this is.
This is Margaret Strom. I wanted to make sure everybody got her that she is the membership chair, right? And so if you join the Rehearsal Club, which is an ongoing organization at this point, even if you're not as young as Chani and Julia, you can still become a member of the Rehearsal Club and be part of that community. So, talk to Margaret.
Right. Men, too. Men can join as general members.
Men can join, yes. Yes. We love you all.
You can go above the first floor.
Right. Okay, so this is Cameron, and she just went. And Nancy.
Do you want to say anything?
Yeah, yeah, that's Nancy.
Okay, Nancy White.
Yeah. I'm older than most of these people, except for these three here. I'm a few years past all these people, but the Rehearsal Club is a wonderful place. I came from Maine to dance with Boston Ballet, and that was boot camp. And then I landed in New York, and I got to work with a choreographer at the Metropolitan Opera, and he was wonderful to work with. And then I formed a base of friendships at the Rehearsal Club. Carolyn Eddy, former Miss Virginia, and Carrie Slattery, who was an actress. And she introduced me to Donna Michi once. And I.
Carrie also runs the Starlight. Well, she used to run the Starlight bookstore in LA, and she's helping us get the book into the LA.
Great. Yeah. And Gail Robinson was a suite mate of mine. And Gail died young, unfortunately. She used to come in late at night singing, and people would say, "Shut up, Gail, shut up." She ended up as a leading soprano at the Metropolitan Opera House.
Oh.
And I knew she had a world-class voice. And she was wonderful. She was tall, but she had serious health issues. And she was always homesick for Tennessee.
Oh.
And the Rehearsal Club wasn't run down, Denise.
I thought it was.
I was invited to a dinner one night, I'll be brief here, World Wildlife Federation or something at a fancy hotel. It's my father's cousin who invited me. He was much, much older, of course. And he was a very wealthy man. And Mrs. Hemingway was there. And Cousin Chauncey took me home in his Rolls Royce. Nobody saw this. But yeah, he said, when I got out of his Rolls, he said to me, "Oh, what a beautiful old brownstone." I didn't know I lived in a brownstone.
Hi, I lived at the Rehearsal. My name's Judith Curcio. And I lived at the Rehearsal Club 64, 66.
Okay.
And unfortunately, I did not tell my story. I probably should tell my story.
Oh, the book.
It is. Anyway, it was a wonderful place to live. Have very fond memories of Diane Keaton and her wonderful sense of humor. We really have to try to find her.
Well, I tried. I did do it. Diane and Christina Gillespie had a, Diane and Celia Weston did the recent film Palms. And there was this fabulous picture of Diane and Celia. And I couldn't get it released. I couldn't find Diane. I tried. Mm-hmm. I did everything I could. But that picture is not in the gallery. There's another picture of Celia who did Alice in, what was she? She was the little Southern waitress in Alice. She was so great. Right? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, so we're not connected, but I can't.
We will find her.
We
just have to put it out.
Yeah, well, in the universe. Diane Keaton, if anybody knows her, please send her our way.
Sunny.
Hi. I'm Sunny Kaiser. I was in the 60s of the Rehearsal Club. I pretended I was there in the late 60s for a long time when I was lying about my age. however, it was the early 60s. I don't see Maria. She was one of my...
Maria's here.
Oh, my God. I didn't recognize her from here.
Yes.
Yes. I'm sorry.
Beautiful. Yes. 6 o'clock in the morning.
When I'm left with the Rehearsal Club, the most beautiful part of the Rehearsal Club is what I'm looking at now.
Oh.
It is that we have, none of us knew each other. I mean, we all came in different years. Some of us knew each other. But the fact that we were brought together a lot by Michelle and her meditation class, but Denise, the charger.
The charger.
Charger, yeah. And if she has an idea, if she has an idea, you better get ready to work hard at it, okay? But anyway, I just love being with all the rehearsal club people. I did work, I did do things, but I don't even know how I got to the rehearsal club. I'll never forget coming to the door. Somebody sent me that day, because I came to New York to look for an apartment. I was going in all the bad neighborhoods, all the wrong neighborhoods. I was told it was dangerous, I didn't know. It was that, and all of a sudden somebody said, well, why don't you try there? And there I was at that door, and that day I was accepted.
Oh, yay.
And what a gift it really was.
I think we have to thank the house mother, because somehow they let us all in. Who's on class?
No longer.
They selected.
And we all had different house mothers.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. I read somewhere that the selection was who would be most likely to make it.
That's hard.
I was at the American Academy.
I'd like to say a word about the house mother. Mrs. Walker. And Mrs. Walker, I don't remember anybody else saying this, but every day, Mrs. Walker somehow got herself to the front door before I left, and she always said to me, walk straight ahead, keep your head up, look straight ahead, and don't swing your arms. Now, I mean, she said it to me every day, so there must have been something about what I was doing that she thought she needed to say that. Anyway, so Mrs. Walker.
Thank you.
Yes.
She tippled a bit.
Mm-hmm. Yes, she did. Yes. Well, lots of Debbie there. And it, throughout the stories, they talk about the scotch tape on Mrs. Clayton. Yes. That's been repeated a couple of times.
Well, anyway, she did that. She did have scotch tape between her eyebrows. She did it as a beauty regimen, so she wouldn't have wrinkles between her eyebrows.
Yeah.
And that's a theme throughout many of our stories in the 70s. I want to thank everybody who came today.
Yes.
Our friends, Sandy, Betsy, and Patricia, and Stephen, and Joanne, and everybody else. And they came in to support the Rehearsal Club. And
David,
thank you so much.
Sonia.
Thanks.
David, is Sonia here? Okay. She stepped out. We all have those friends. This was a very wonderful, friendly audience for all of us. And we greatly appreciate all of you being here. Now, the next level is if you bought a book and you want signatures, we're going to stay in these places. Does everybody have a pen? I have a lot of pens. Okay. Okay. They're going to pull this table out. Girls, come out a little bit, and they'll put some chairs back there so you can sit down.
Come on, ladies, step right up. 40 good.